I arrived Thursday afternoon with Dave Clark and Tom Nosing for the convention that was to start on Friday. We shared a cab to Union Square, which was really slow because of the World Series traffic. Got to the hotel about 3:15, and my plan was to walk to the ferry building to meet the 4:15 Larkspur ferry. My plan was to meet my sister and my cousin Mavis, and we did meet. The AES convention starts on Friday at the Moscone Center. There was not too many people there early in the morning, but there was an army of student volunteers. Is that the student volunteers?
There's one. No, that's
female. Went past them.
Went past them. Those are the student volunteers. Okay, the first thing I did was meet the Munich Convention Chair and AES President Jan Bildgaard Pedersen. That's Jan. And he handed me an invitation to the President's reception that evening at 10 p.m.
Any hors d'oeuvres?
And there developed, yes, a intricate plan for Friday evening. The traditional AES organ concert was to be at St. Mark's Lutheran, and guests are welcome. It's a 1.4-mile walk from the Moscone Center. So the last paper was at 5:30, and there were six to meet for dinner at 6 o'clock. Tom, Dick, and David, me, my sister, Greta, and our friend Kathy, and most important, Kathy's car. This was at the Kim Tan restaurant. Are we on the Kim Tan restaurant? On Geary, just west of Jones. Dave Clark found this one 2 years ago. We were walking to a similar organ concert. He looked across the street and said, that one would be good. And it was. And it was good this time, too. On to the organ concert. Four in Kathy's little car, and Dick and Dave walking the six blocks. The organ concert was an all-Bach program on a German-style organ. Page Turner Dave Griesinger was replaced by Francis Ramsey, the very tall individual. The organist was Graham Blythe, as at all AES organ concerts. And this time we had the organ groupies. And on to the President's reception at the Palace Hotel, where the organ groupies did somewhat dent Poppy Cum's grand entrance in A Dress to Die For. Concluding the fashion report, and seriously, back to audio. On the exhibit floor, Mike blast filters made of pantyhose have been supplanted by metal mesh.
Oh my.
The Stedman Pro Screen 100. Is that what's on the screen now?
Yeah.
Okay, went too fast. Also, microphone companies have moved into loudspeakers. So now we have the Neumann KH124A in a 5.1 setup. And now seriously back to audio.
Probably very expensive speakers.
One might surmise. The Automotive Audio Technical Committee went over the results of the 48th conference in Munich, presented by Chairman Jan Bildgaard Pedersen. And there was talk of the next automotive audio conference in 2 or 3 years. The United States was favored, but not Detroit. It was felt that last time the automotive industry participation was not significant, and so they're hoping for a different location. Austin, Texas was mentioned, and which would get you the semiconductor industry, or Phoenix, the aftermarket. Also San Francisco, where you get Apple, Dolby, and Microsoft. San Diego, South America, anywhere with appeal and flights. Question was raised by Alan Trevena of when will new features be introduced, such as height or 3D. Of course, he was tagged for his own idea. Quality and consistency was raised by Steve Hutt. Is that Steve? Okay, we're still in sync. Too bad I can't see the slides this time, even with the mirror. Question was also raised of, is there a bottleneck when you're trying to get audio streaming over your phone into your car? Can the cell tower handle everybody in a traffic jam getting audio data? Nobody seemed to know the answer to that. Also, am I still on? Is that Stroud?
Mm-hmm.
Dosimeter was suggested for car level, for the sound level in a car. So that the customer knows how loud the thing's playing and what their dose is over time. Poppy Crumb's session had mentioned that damage to the ear is accelerated if subsonics are presented to the ear with the music.
And you don't drink orange juice. And you don't have your share of orange juice.
Correct. This is part of the...
Yeah.
But I'm trying to stick to the Automotive Audio Technical Committee here.
Yeah.
So the suggestion was to not open the windows so that you don't get the buffeting sound while you're listening to your music. The Heiser lecture was presented by J.J. Johnston, father of MP3. Some people felt that his lecture was extremely good and mentioned many of the things that he said at other times during the convention. Some others thought that he really didn't say enough and didn't go into enough detail.
Overcompressed.
There was a question from the floor, and the question was, is 1644.1 enough? And JJ answered, most of the time 16-bit is fine. But in his ultra-quiet living room, maybe 18 might be needed. And he prefers something like 64 kilohertz sampling. He said he's designed a lot of filters, and 64 kilohertz filters would be much easier to design. So a sort of self-answer. The loudspeaker and headphone technical committee discussed the first ever loudspeaker and headphone conference. You should be seeing Juha Bachmann at the left there. He's the chairman of this conference in Helsinki in August, late August of 2013. There will be warnings to come on portable audio devices about their sound pressure level risks. But Juha questions their accuracy due to the frequency response peaks in the earbuds. And his colleagues at Nokia are really frustrated by these upcoming regulations. The keynote speaker was Steve Lillywhite. Is that Steve Lillywhite?
No, there's a...
Still a conference? Still a conference? Steve Lillywhite. Steve Lillywhite is a producer. He's known for the Rolling Stones, U2, Peter Gabriel, Counting Crows, the Dave Matthews Band, and 30 Seconds to Mars. So most of the talk was much of interest to music people. But a questioner came up and asked a leading question. And he was expecting an answer favoring analog recording. But Lillywhite said, tape playback always sounds different from the original, and digital always sounds the same as the original. So here's a producer. The tide may have changed. One day I sat down for lunch on the floor, because that was the available place, and this girl next to me said, holding up her bottle of Snapple, how much did this cost? I said, extrapolating the sandwich price to a bottle of Snapple, I came up with $4, and she says, yeah, that's what it is. And she wasn't too happy with that. And she went on to talk about all kinds of things. She wanted to know if I'd heard anything interesting at the convention. She seemed to be sort of promoting herself. She has a studio, well, actually she's a double E, University of Florida, in hardware engineering, but she also has her studio, which she calls Shotgun the Moon Studios. And I think after the meeting we'll go on the web and listen to her video.
Okay. Where is your studio?
University of Florida.
Oh, Florida.
So she's shaken up with Ken Bowman?
You can judge that for yourself when you see the video.
Okay.
It was a workshop on the controversy over upsampling. Now, I'm expecting this to be upsampling to 5.1, and no, it's not. It's on high-resolution Blu-ray or DVD or HD downloads that are created by upsampling from 44.1 or 48 kilohertz originals. And there have been cries of fraud over this. You're selling the HD, but it's really a 44.1 that's been upsampled. Vicki Melchior, a consultant from Lynn, Massachusetts, pointed out that rate converters, all the devices that do this upsampling, use off-the-shelf chips. So they all do basically the same thing. Bob Katz of Digital Domain Mastering in Orlando, Florida, described his mastering workflow. He often gets 24/44 files. This is how they say it now, and they don't even put a slash or divider. It's just 2444 is 2444. He upsamples to 3296. He uses Sericon, which is a 3296 piece of software, as are most digital audio workstations. When he comes out of there, he dithers to 24-bit. So he's going out AES-EBU, and he wants to dither before he goes down to 24. Then he'll do his analog processing, such as an API compressor. Coming out of the analog, he will A to D at 2496, so he can use a peak limiter plug-in at 3296. He will then convert to 3244 before dithering to 1644 for CD, or dithering to 2444 for MFIT. MFIT is mastered for iTunes. There's a lot of talk about mastered for iTunes at the convention. Apple does not accept 32-bit. You have to give them 24-bit.
After all those stages, does it still sound good or look good or whatever?
He says everything he does is to make it sound good.
Trying to include pictures on Photoshop by oversampling and undersampling and dithering and fractals and all that. It's the same darn thing. Just gets worse and worse.
It works perfectly. Didn't you ever watch CSI?
Yeah.
Okay. Rhonda Wilson of Dolby Laboratories in San Francisco. She previously was with Meridian in the UK for 20 years, and now she's working for Dolby. She created an upsampling apodizing filter. An apodizing filter is one that is designed to avoid pre-ringing. The terminology she gave is linear phase filter gives pre-ring and post-ring. You're familiar with the plots of those from CD players that have pre-ring and post-ring. A minimum phase filter gives only post-ring. And she's invented the term maximum phase filter for those filters that give only pre-ring. So this is an apodizing filter that gives only post-ring. It is minus 2/1000ths of a dB at 20 kilohertz, minus 6/1000ths of a dB at 23 kilohertz, and minus 79 dB at 24 kilohertz. She calls this a monotonic passband because it has no ripple in the passband region. In the stop band, it's below 100 dB, and it has the usual humps, the hillocks, of reject filters. Then Poppy Crum, also with Dolby Laboratories, came on to describe testing of this apodizing filter. They used movie source material at 48 kilohertz and used this filter going into lossless coding. They used an RME Hammerfall DSP digiface I saw one of those at Chrysler yesterday. I was really surprised. It was there. I don't know who had it or why. A MyTech 8x96 ADAT light pipe to go to AES EBU into Grace M906 DAC and Briston 4BST amplifiers and Rebel Ultima Studio speakers. You got that? The task she gave the listeners was to identify the reference between two alternatives. And she stated the results show that the listeners heard the appetizing filter beyond chance. They heard this marvelous filter. It's being different from a conventional filter. And what she is bringing forth is what I, some optical illusions that suggest there's greater power in human mind's ability to apprehend these flaws in various audio and visual processing. We now have a optical illusion on the screen. You'll notice that the gray circle appears to be completely uniform in its gray color, where in normal optical illusions, you would expect to see the gray shifted by the white in the darker direction and by the black in the lighter direction. But you notice in this, the circle is entirely even.
Almost.
When you put in the dividing line, now you see the classic illusion. This is a new illusion. This is one that's not been shown before. And what Poppy says about this is that the brain looks for the relevant unit. It tries to make order, averages, homogenizes, and we can see this illusion just by adding a little tiny line. We see the classic illusion. Without it, you don't. So it makes the gray circle just a gray circle when there's no dividing line. Out of the slides now, I believe. And I want to change the picture on the internet.
A general question. Why is it such a dark picture?
That's the way I wanted it to be.
It's a good answer.
It's artistic.
The broadcast group presented a session on HTML5 by Greg Oganowski of Orbat. He explained that HTML5 is attempting to be the universal web language, but Flash has cornered the market. So HTML5 is competing with Flash, with Silverlight, and other products that are seemingly ahead at the moment. He pointed out that MP3 still cost a 2% royalty on each legitimate song. And the more efficient HEAAC doesn't have a song royalty. You buy the software, you pay the fee, and you can use it. There's a new open source audio codec. It's called OGG Opus, O-G-G. He wanted to make it very clear to everyone that Pandora is not streaming. Pandora is actually a download. And they're very distinct processes, and he wanted to be sure that people understood the difference. I can't thoroughly explain it. In another paper, Huang Tran of Oralware and several co-authors presented a subjective evaluation of personalized EQ curves in music. His theory is that each individual likes music with a certain EQ applied. And he gave his test listeners several fixed EQs to select from. And they could pick their favorite. Now, they looked rather extreme to me as they went plus or minus 6 dB. He presented the music at 75 dB SPL, 4 to 8 seconds only of sound. These 4 to 8 second bits were selected from 70 there were 70 of them. They were selected from pop and rock music. with no more than 16 excerpts per song, and no phrase was cut. That's why it's 4 to 8 seconds. He used very short selections, and he claimed to demonstrate each person's chosen personally cue was preferred when it was presented in the second sessions 4 weeks later. That is, they listened to it, picked their favorite, they came back 4 weeks later, and were played the various EQs, and they picked theirs as sounding the best. Okay, I get everything but the really severe EQ curves. Brett Leonard of McGill presented a paper on the effect of environment on reverberation level preference. This is on mixing in a studio, in a control room. He added reflective walls inside a typical good studio, so he could raise the reverb time by 40 milliseconds and raise the total energy. Then he had expert mixers add reverb to a fixed known track on two consecutive days, one with the normal good acoustics of the studio and the other with the highly accentuated reverb due to his panels. He found the amount of reverb added was slightly less with a added local reverb, about 1 dB. But there's less variation among the mix engineers in that environment with the high reverb. So it's there, not a very big effect. Sean Olive of Harman International presented a paper on the relationship between perception and measurements of headphones. He led off explaining that the IEC standard for headphones does not appear to be used very much. It calls for a 12 dB peak at about 4 kHz. Another worker, Lorho, suggests only a 3 dB peak at 3 kHz. But the headphone makers just seem to do whatever they want. So he created a blind test of headphones. And of course, that's very, very difficult to make it blind. What he did was selected 6 circumoral headphones. He had the usual Harman handheld PC to select which headphone you wanted to be on, and an administrator would put it on your head, so you didn't handle the phones. If you needed to tweak the headphones position slightly, he had ties on the phone, so you pulled on a tie, not on the headphone itself. And you could feel the surface against your head. He hadn't found a way to blind that. He had the subjects always look forward, and he had them rank the phones by subjective frequency response. That ranking agreed with smooth and flat on a grass 42 AC coupler with pinup, which differs from the IEC recommendation. It proves that the IEC standard 60268-7 is not optimal. Of course, he didn't tell us what the right answer is because it's going to be very hard to get to it the way he's working on it. But he's confirmed that the usual standard is wrong and that there is a sort of way to measure somewhat close to what's right. Juha Bachmann, again from Nokia in Finland, did a paper on mid-range resonance scattering in loudspeakers. This is about the effects of ports and horns next to piston speakers. He also included horns next to horns in his analysis. He included shallow horns, which are very common on current loudspeakers like Genelec, JBL, and Neumann. He found these surface conditions to be a very significant source of coloration. And primarily it was the resonance that the model showed was present when you had like a port next to a speaker. The resonance in the port itself at the higher frequency affected the output of the system. Marshall Buck, Psychotechnology in Los Angeles, has been talking for a few conventions about a very, very loud speaker, and he's now taken to calling it a loud hailer, for its possibly a little bit more distortion than you might like, at which point Arnie snores.
That's pure distortion.
Right.
That's an R.
And as Marshall was starting to speak, his computer popped up with an Adobe Flash update. And Marshall said, Adobe products spend 90% of their time updating and 10% of their time in actual use.
Ouch.
I found that to be quite
yep.
true.
Yep.
Now, this induction speaker has a fixed primary coil and a moving secondary coil. So you induce the current in the moving coil. You don't have any flex leads. This has been described in a 1923 telephone receiver document. And in a patent by Graebner of Wisdom Audio. Graebner was a co-author on the paper with Marshall. They built this driver and put it on a 2 by 30 degree horn. The BL's 42. Uh-huh. 1 watt, 1 meter is 130 dB SPL. So 300 watt input gets you 83 watts out. Acoustic. 500 watts gets you 98 dB SPL at 500 meters.
Jeez.
500 meters.
The army, come out, surrender.
That's what it's for. Richard Little of Far North Acoustics in Surrey, British Columbia, did an indirect study of compliance and damping in the Timpani LAT device. I don't know if you guys remember what the LAT is.
Oh, yes.
It's some smallish distant elements that move toward each other so that the sound goes this way, hooked by rods to each other. Mm-hmm. This one is about an 8-inch speaker with about 2.5-inch pistons. The rods do go through the pistons, so there's some leakage at the rods. He said he couldn't get the laser onto the diaphragm, so he invented this method he described to analyze it. He did a manual curve fit. He called it manual. He used a Monte Carlo method to fit to the impedance curve. And he got a pretty good fit below resonance, a so-so fit from resonance to the impedance minimum. He was asked a question by Wolfgang Klippel. Klippel said, the Klippel analyzer does not need a laser for nonlinear analysis. And you really don't need it, says Wolfgang. And somebody said, well, you want to sell him one, don't you? And Wolfgang said, yes, yes, it's very important to have the laser. And I recall the original Klippel analyzer didn't have a laser connection at all. I said, Wolfgang, didn't your first analyzer not have a laser? He said, yeah, that's true. Wolfgang gave a presentation on the large signal behavior of micro speakers. He pointed out that the back EMF is really important for damping because there's not much other damping in a micro speaker. So mechanical resistance can help if you want to stick something in there. Forget about inductance. It's really, really small. He went on to show a model of the nonlinear behavior of micro speakers confirmed with measurements. Benjamin Bernschulz, Cologne University of Applied Science in Germany, did a real smoothums project. This is bandwidth extension for microphone arrays. He referenced a existing product from MH Acoustics called the EigenMic. This has 32 transducers. It can give you the position of a source. But it can't do really high frequencies because there's only 32 transducers. To do 20 kilohertz would require 1,200 mics. So his solution was a scanning microphone, which would avoid that aliasing. He used two motors, and it worked really well. He was able to get positions at really high frequencies with great accuracy. Of course, it's not real time like the EigenMic. but he's able to get positioned with this scanning microphone.
They're all bunched together like a fly's eye?
On the 32 mic, yeah. Mm-hmm. Correct. Back to the broadcast group, there was a session on listener fatigue and listener retention. Sounded like it might be really interesting, particularly the broadcasters actually fatiguing their own listeners and thereby not retaining them. But somehow it didn't really seem to be about that. Stephen Ambrose of Osseous Technologies in Longmont, California, claims there is a hearing fatigue with a blocked ear canal, like your tight-fitting earphone. He claims the stapedius is triggered by the closed pressure and starts beating like a heartbeat. He showed a video of an otoscope of his own eardrum pulsating. Later in this session, there was a video promo of the Ambrose diaphonic ear lens, which is some kind of membrane which is claimed to protect the ear from this situation. Little skepticism started. Dead on. Yes. Sean Olive was in this session as well, and he gave his paper that we've seen on teenagers prefer good sound. It didn't really seem to fit the topic very well. Robert Reams of Streaming Applications, DSP Concepts of Mill Creek, Washington, claims that adaptation of your ear is affected by circumstances. That he claims vision affects hearing, and smell affects hearing. If there's a burning smell in the area, you can't enjoy music. He claims that hearing affects vision.
It's your power supply.
If you're grooving to music in your car, you don't see well and you miss turns. He claims the motion of visual objects can cause hearing fatigue, and that complex tasks are affected more strongly. He's talking about image cognition ballistics, expecting sound to be in the wrong place because of what you see. He claims that too soft music as well as too loud can cause fatigue, because the missing information in a too soft presentation has to be filled in by brain effort.
Well, I've seen people fall asleep with music playing in the background.
I don't think that's quite what he's talking about. The whole thing was very, very persuasive sounding, but he really didn't seem to show any data, which is kind of what you need to indicate that there are these interferences from one sense to the other. The Platin Producers and Engineers session included a lot more talk about MFIT. Everybody remember what MFIT is? MFIT product is a 256K AAC variable bit rate. And to create this, they require a 24-bit submission. And you can submit it to CD Baby and have it come out as an MFIT. The fears were expressed that MFIT would become a source to other data schemes, and the risk that the data reduction would then sound bad, such as Sirius XM. They're really worried if an MFIT was shipped to Sirius XM and played over the satellite radio, that it would sound bad. Now, if you've listened to Sirius XM, you might wonder how they can make it sound.
Garbage always out.
So he advocated the original file had to go to Sirius XM for good broadcast. This stuff still goes on. Andreas Fietze of the University of Applied Science in Mainz, Germany, presented a little 15-minute engineering brief on something called Sync AV, which is a workflow tool for file-based video shootings. It's an e-script for a smartphone. So the whole crew gets what's going on their own phone during the shoot, and they can be even in different locations. This thing is a lot more than it sounds like in the tiny description and the 15 minutes he had to talk about it. It can handle a whole production's documentation. It can export an EDL to Premiere, so you can be working on your editing while you're shooting and storing it in this tool. Don't know how he is promoting it or where it's available, but it really looks like a powerful tool. Nadia Valaskovits of the Austrian Academy of Science has given presentations previously and again this year on the replay of historical magnetic tape. There are several intriguing points. First was the early tape made by IG Farben, now known as BASF, had no binder at all. The cellulose acetate was partially dissolved, and the iron oxide was cast into it. So there's no binder. It's just you sort of put a solvent near the acetate, push the iron oxide in, smoosh it down, and now it's cast in place. So you have the disadvantage that the cellulose acetate will shrink over time, but the metal won't. So curving, wrinkling is a big problem with this tape. She also said that early tape came from the manufacturer with splices, so that there could be some quality variations in a recording that was actually due to the blank stock. Paper tape didn't have these problems. The cellulose acetate tape can be restored by adding a plasticizer. She doesn't say how to do this, but it improves the tensile strength by about 10%, which is significant. It allows it to fit the head better and play better. Another interesting little fact is 1938 tapes were 6.5 millimeters wide. Today's recorders with quarter inch are 6.3 millimeters. You put the old tape on, you're going to damage it. She suggests to minimize print through in playing an old recording to rewind the tape three times to sort of erase the print through a little bit before you actually play it. Early stereo had 2.3 millimeter tracks and today's heads have 2 millimeter tracks. But she does recommend stereo playback of even full track tapes because you've got a big advantage in post-processing, being able to get at the edges. She also talked a great deal about these antique recordings containing metadata. Notes on the box, metadata. The German metal hubs for the tape have notes written on them, metadata. And those little pieces of paper you stick in the tape pack as it's winding up to indicate where you are, and you put a note on there, it's more metadata. She showed pictures of the earliest known example of the magnetophone made by AEG, models K4, serial numbers 1260. Another interesting fact, Jack Mullen, who brought magnetophones to the United States, made his own amplifiers. He didn't use magnetophone amplifiers. She didn't give any explanation for this. The magnetophone head was very classic, circular, with a coil on one side and a gap on the other. But the erase head had this great big foot off one side of it. The incoming side traveled across the metal for a long time before reaching the gap. She didn't really have an explanation for that. Just, there it is. Now back to Wolfgang Klippel on rub and buzz and other irregular loudspeaker distortions. Of course, he wants us to use his oralization to evaluate the sound of the speaker. But he's also claiming an end-of-line sweep is not adequate. Suspension's not broken in. Requires a trained listener. The listener gets fatigued. And we really want a test that's more like the actual application. Also, the end-of-line sweep is fairly time-consuming because you've got a human operator who has to connect it, hold it up, turn the oscillator dial, or push go, or whatever. He thinks it's not very reliable. He also mentions the high turnover of personnel around Chinese New Year. It's a running theme with Wolfgang, was the turnover of personnel at Chinese New Year. A good test, he says, requires high displacement or high velocity in the speaker. and sufficient low-frequency content in the source signal. Microphone close to the driver, and really a good microphone, not a little electret, but the actual high-quality measurement microphone. He wants to low-pass the stimulus and high-pass the mic, so that you're not putting much highs in, but that's what you're listening to. And then he does a time domain analysis on that. He noted that high pass as a technique was advocated 20 years ago, but FFT came along and was thought to be more cool, but it didn't really work that well. So now today he's advocating high pass and analysis as a way to see if there's something wrong with the new speaker. He notes that rub and buzz are most often audible at mid-voltage. He wants to do a cluster analysis of faulty parts to see where problems lie so that we know what to look for. And he wants to measure more sensitively than the ear of the customer. Well, that's a great goal. Of course, you know, you can buy a lot of software from Wolfgang. He uses the Farina method. Now, this is an exponential chirp. The time-reversed and exponentially weighted version of this stimulus is convolved with the speaker's response. The result is the speaker's impulse response, but it's a series of impulses. The latest is the speaker's linear response. The other impulses are the nonlinear responses. The inverse transform of the separate impulses reveal first linear frequency response without distortion. The next impulse, you get a distortion order response versus frequency, and so on for increasing orders, all of the ones you can get out of a particular combination of the sweep and the convolution. This is something that Wolfgang is using in his software today. There were these engineering briefs, 15 minutes, I mentioned one earlier. Engineering brief session 4, number 3, was actually a commercial for a maker of line chord filters for EMC. I think we really need to make a report to the society about that. It was a commercial. Another engineering brief was John Vanderkoy of the University of Waterloo. He called it Another View of Distortion Perception. 44 years ago, in Cambridge, at university, he made a distortion generator with a germanium diode. And he found that the percentage of distortion you could hear was a fairly high number, like 3, 4, 5%. Down below that, you couldn't hear it at all. He submitted it to Wireless World, where it was rejected because those numbers just didn't fit with the expectations. And of course, I emailed him after the convention to say that this was exactly the form of distortion used by the AVX company in the Chamber of Horrors grunge box, which he's acknowledged that he even likes Dave's circuit a little better than his own.
He somehow used a germanium diode open loop?
That's what he said. He didn't put a circuit up.
Okay. The ABX one was, of course, just a precision half-wave rectifier.
And he did come up with a later circuit that was somewhat similar, mm-hmm. but he acknowledges yours looks even a little better than his second one.
Better distortion.
Well, we all know what percent we could hear in the grunge box. It's around 3, 4, 5, depending on the material.
Yeah, exactly. And 2.5 of the... Sine waves, you could hold your head just right and get under 1% or something.
Oh, like we could do a 10th percent on sine waves, easy. But music? Totally different. Which is exactly what Vanderkoy said he found when he was at Cambridge.
Well, they didn't listen to our results and wonder if they're still listening.
At McGill, there's Richard King. And he's got 15 years experience as a recording engineer, and now he's teaching at McGill. He wanted to know, how can sample rates be properly compared in terms of audio quality? just as a given, he took the 24-bit as better than 16. So he wasn't asking about bit depth, and he ran his experiments at 24-bit. What he set up was a disc clavier to repeat and play music over and over. He mic'd it with 4006 TLDPA microphones, that's the Brulin Care Omni, into a Grace M802 preamp sitting out in the studio at the piano. That went into an API Vision console where three or four multiple outputs were fed to A to D to A converters and a straight wire. He had three MiTek 8x192 A to D, D to A converters. One was running at 44.1, the next at 96, and the third at 192. The monitor switching of the API allowed listening to the hardwire or one of these converters. And he allowed his listeners to switch freely between the four alternatives, and they were supposed to rank the four with written answers and also give a number for how close the second one was to the first and how close the third one was to the first. Then he would reorder the switch and have them do it again. He did 393 trials and the results were entirely random. Now this guy really hoped for a difference to be heard. He made it plain that he was looking for a difference. So he gave some explanations. One is the possibility that you really can't hear this difference. Second was that the Bach sonata that he had this in the disc clavier playing didn't really have any pauses, so you couldn't hear any room decay. Also, overall, the sound of the piano wasn't that bright. He suggested the test was too difficult, and he will continue. Now, I sort of agree it was too difficult if you're trying to rank four and give how far off they are. It's a pretty difficult test, but he's going to continue doing this.
Because he doesn't have any alternative, because his funds will dry up.
Publish or perish. Peter Eastie of Oxford Digital presented what he called balanced phase equalization. This is for the case where you have signals that go in different paths with and without EQ, and you want to mix them again later. This requires that the phase matches. And he presented a scheme with IIR filters that could do this. It requires a cascade of two filters, the squared response. So he puts biquads in series, and the first biquad goes to a second one that has reciprocal zeros to the first. But he puts an all pass in the compensating path. So he's really got two paths, he's equalizing them both to get the phase to line up after he's mixed them. There is a patent involved, so I don't know that this is going to be all that exciting. Bobby Osinski did a tutorial on social media with a little piece of trivia. The keywords in an HTML tag should be held to five, because Google will score you down for having more words than five in your keyword tag. Verena Fuchs of the University of Siegen in Germany gave a paper on silicon carbide semiconductors for a Class D amplifier, demonstrating that they are really, really fast and work really, really well. I don't know where we stand on cost performance for silicon carbide transistors. But
for power supply?
Amplifier, Class D amplifier. Jay McKnight was presenting on misconceptions about magnetic tape recording history. He did a section on when was AC bias first used. Carlson and Carpenter in the United States included AC bias in the 1921 telegraph patent. It was rediscovered independently in several other locations. Best known is Weber and Braunmühl in Germany in 1938 to 1941. It was also noted in Japan in 1933, Kamras in the United States, and by Woolridge at Bell Laboratories in the United States in 1938. But Bell Labs delayed the public publication of Woolrich's paper until 1946. So the 1939 Bell Labs World's Fair tape recorder, well, it was a steel band recorder, had DC bias. Even though they knew about AC, they didn't use it. McKnight said that Commerce has 20 pages on how it works. And McKnight is still seeking real explanation about how AC bias, makes magnetic recording linear. He's not really satisfied with any of the explanations. And I'm going to go out on a limb here. To me, I've always sort of felt I did understand AC bias on tape. I don't think it makes it linear. I think it's digital.
It's dither.
It's digital. The audio is sampled by the bias, resulting in pulse amplitude modulation, which is then reconstructed by the wide head gap that doesn't see the bias. So of course, it's not linearized, it's actually perfectly linear, because it's AM. And you're sitting there like you want more instead of being bored stiff. What's wrong there? This is the end. That's all I have. This will be the end of the meeting, unless there are more questions.
No, well, I could bring up a small alternative, is that on Sunday night, there was a session of the wrecking crew.
You want to come up and be seen while you're talking?
No, that's okay. We didn't go to it because we all went out to dinner at some corned beef place because of Stroud's indulgence.
How many of the original, 25 or so wrecking crew are still with us?
Well, yeah, the question is, probably quite a few of them. Hal Blaine died recently. Mm-hmm. Leon Russell is still alive and recording. I've seen him, play several times. And of course, I didn't get to hear the presentation, so I don't really know. And Glenn Campbell, of course.
Yep, sure.
That's it.
All right.
This program has been a production of the Southeastern Michigan Woofer and Tweeter Marching Society. Opinions expressed during this program are those of the individual speaking and not necessarily the opinion of the Southeastern Michigan Woofer and Tweeter Marching Society.